In the 17th century, the century of the telescope, Western science takes a new look at the universe. Europeans cross the Atlantic and struggle to build homes there. In Brazil, a new population arrives from Africa, brought against their will as slaves. New trade routes shift wealth to the west. Eastern spices finance the Dutch Golden Age. In China, the empire's self-confident isolation is challenged by superior science from the West. 1,000 years of history. Millennium. In the 17th century, science transformed our view of the universe. Isaac Newton was its spokesman.
If I have seen further, it is by standing upon the shoulders of giants.
Newton's giants were scientific heroes who sought to explain the workings of the universe. At London's Globe Theatre, Shakespeare's audiences heard their world described wondrously.
The heavens themselves, the planets, and this center observe degree, priority, and place, insisture, course, proportion, season, form, office, and custom in all line of order.
Until now, that order had been known only to God. Now science enabled men to examine its secrets. They would find that the universe obeys simple laws, intelligible to the human mind. Science extended the reach of the senses. It made the moons of Jupiter visible, made unheard sounds audible, and explained the pull of gravity, the force that bound the cosmos. Europe's rulers were now willing to invest in science. Knowledge was power. The hunt was on. As England emerged from bloody civil conflicts, science replaced war as a means of securing honor and title. The English diarist, Samuel Pepys, was caught up in the excitement.
At noon to the coffee house, where with Dr. Allen, some good discourse about physic and chemistry. Thence, by agreement, we all of us go to the Blue Balls. I discoursed with Mr. Hook about the nature of sounds, and he told me that having come to a certain number of vibrations proper to make any tone, he was thus able to tell how many times a fly beat her wings.
I, too, conducted a pretty experiment of the blood of one dog let out till it died into the body of yet another while his own ran out. The first died, but the other lives yet.
I understand that the dog filled with another dog's blood is doing very well.
And is likely to do so for a long time.
Dreams of wealth and rank inspired minds across Europe. A farmer's son who played with fireworks attached to a kite to see how light travelled rose to be a knight and a companion of kings. Isaac Newton.
Plato is my friend. Aristotle is my friend. But my best friend is truth.
His quest for truth made Newton a hero. At Trinity College, Cambridge, sheltered and supported, he was a typical absent-minded professor. It was said that he was unable to find his way around the college, but he could comprehend the universe. Newton went beyond the authority of Aristotle and Plato to observation and experiment. He began with light and vision.
I take a bodkin and put it betwixt my eye and the bone, as near to the backside of my eye as I can, and pressing my eye with the end of it, there appear several white, dark, and coloured circles.
Newton dissected a rainbow from a beam of light. This was a continuation of magic by other means, the control of nature through knowledge. The science of the 17th century started by looking at how the world really works. Newton measured the way ordinary objects behave when they collide. He found their movements were predictable, governed by universal laws and exact arithmetic. God, it seemed, was a mathematician. To Newton, the universe worked like a clock. Set in motion by God and turned by the force that made an apple or a raindrop fall. Gravity. Newton saw that gravity, the same force that pulled a falling apple to the ground, worked across space. Gravity kept the moons in their orbits around the planets, and the planets in their orbits around the sun, regularly and predictably. For Newton, nature burned with the fire of the divine mind. He imagined the universe as a machine tuned by God, the celestial engineer.
A certain infinite spirit pervades all space and contains and vivifies the universal world. In him we live and move and have our being. Hence, the omnipresent God is acknowledged.
The fame and honor heaped on Newton towards the end of his life never displaced his childlike curiosity or dispelled his sense of awe.
I don't know what I may appear to the world, but as to myself, I seem to have been like a boy playing on the seashore and diverting myself in now and then finding a smoother pebble or a prettier shell than the ordinary. While the great ocean of truth lay all before me.
In the century of the telescope, magic and superstition were marginalized and replaced by simple universal laws of physics. In 1606, James, King of England, granted a charter to open up the Americas.
They shall and may begin their first plantation and seat of their first abode and habitation at any place on the coast of Virginia.
This next little creek we're going to be entering here at the end of the Yap Basin is Powhatan Creek. That's named after the great chief Powhatan, or Wanun Senecacus was his Indian name. So it's kind of interesting to think of all the historical characters that have traveled the same waterways that we're going to be traveling on today.
Hi, y'all. I wait to pull the bucket up like this. Do you have your water?
Joyful news out of the newfound world, wherein is declared the rare and singular virtues of diverse and sundry herbs, trees, oils, and precious stones. Without doubt, a paradise found out to be true.
The Virginia Company's advertising campaign had assembled 100 potential colonists, aristocratic second sons, treasure hunters, not a farmer or a woman amongst them.
The land we have searched out is a good land, most sweet and wholesome, much warmer than England and very agreeable to our natures. Wheresoever we landed upon this river, we saw the goodliest woods, and all the grounds bespread with fruits, strawberries, mulberries, raspberries. It is inhabited with wild and savage people, like herds of deer in a forest. They have no law but nature.
The Native Americans did not feel threatened when this small band of ill-adapted Europeans settled on an isolated, uninhabited site. Jamestown, named after King James, was a mirror image of an English fort, except that it was surrounded by mosquito-ridden swamps, and the drinking supply was contaminated with salt. Disease and hunger claimed the life of one man in two.
There were never Englishmen left in a foreign country in such misery as we were in this new discovered Virginia.
Their survival depended on gifts from the Powhatan people.
The Powhatan people saw the English as being very arrogant and lazy in comparison to our people. Our people were willing to work for their needs, taking the raw materials from the earth, the forest, was bountiful with wild animals and fowl, but they still couldn't seem to find food to eat. And we thought that was strange because we are a people that live in harmony with Earth, and we survive from the Earth. The Earth supplied all of our needs.
Jamestown's self-appointed leader was Captain John Smith, a cunning maverick. Smith needed stable relations with the Powhatan people. Chief Powhatan himself was ruler of an ambitious empire. The Europeans treated him with respect.
The great emperor amongst them we call Powhatan, and sure it is to be wondered at how such a barbarous prince should take unto him such majesty as often strikes awe into our people.
Powhatan saw the newcomers as useful in his wider struggles. Smith claimed to be able to charm goods from the Powhatan people. In reality, he was ruthless. Later, he used terror to force food out of them. Jamestown's gentlemen settlers still behaved as if the New World's empires would fall to them like ninepins. Smith despised them.
Seeing how the authority resteth wholly in myself, you must obey this for a law, that he that will not work shall not eat. For the labors of 30 or 40 honest men shall not be consumed to maintain 150 idle varlets.
Smith's tyrannical rule stabilized the Jamestown colony, but not for long. Smith was injured and forced to return to England. The Powhatan cut off supplies to Jamestown and moved in for the kill.
Now for corn, provision, and contribution from the savages. We had nothing but mortal wounds with clubs and arrows. Of 500, within 6 months after, there remained not many more than 60 most miserable and poor creatures.
Then salvation arrived. Tobacco, a variety smuggled from the Caribbean, grew very successfully in Virginia and in nearby St. Mary's City.
Tobacco is but an Indian weed, grows green in the morn, cut down at eve. It shows our decay, we are the clay. Think of this and take tobacco.
The settlers now had a means of survival. They fenced off greater areas of land, but the climate was still lethal and labor was still short. A solution came by chance. In 1619, a Dutch ship bound for the Caribbean with a cargo of African slaves took shelter from an Atlantic storm. From then on, the colony and colonies which followed would rely on imported labor. By the end of the 17th century, North American colonies were viable, secure outposts of a new civilization which was taking shape around the Atlantic. In the 17th century, Western civilization was black as well as white, African as well as European. Slaves recreated African lives in the Americas. Here in Brazil, the effects are still obvious. A procession to dedicate a church is enlivened by African ebullience and lubricated with magic. Over 1.5 million blacks were shipped to the New World by the end of the 17th century to fuel a new burst of European colonization. Africans were brought here to replace native labor, wiped out by the settlers' diseases. They came to plant new crops. Sugar was the boom product of the 17th century. It transformed Brazil. The land was known as purgatory for Europeans, but hell for Africans, who chopped and crushed the canes and sweated over the boilers in the refineries. Slaves who survived for 10 years would see almost half their fellow workers die. The Jesuit prophet, Antonio de Vieira, who had a black grandmother, told slaves,
"Christ was mistreated, and so are you. Serve your masters, not as one who serves men, but as one who serves God. Then you will not serve as captives, but as free men."
Rules for slave masters in 1663 recommended correction for the ill-behaved.
After being well flogged, he should be pricked with a sharp razor or knife, the wounds rubbed with salt, lemon juice, and urine.
Slaves were taken from almost the whole length of the West African coast and from hundreds of miles inland. They were sold in the Americas for sugar and other crops, which were taken back to Europe and sold for cash to buy more African slaves. 20% didn't survive the crossing. Africa never recovered. Plantation life under white rule was the main experience of Africans in the Americas. There were few slave children. As slaves died, new slaves had to be brought over from Africa. Slave women deliberately restricted the number of children they had. Contraception was a form of resistance. Music, dance, and ritual provided spiritual solace. Black religions are still practiced in Brazil. Candomblé, based on West African traditions, combined African gods and Christian saints. It was tolerated by Europeans who chose to leave it alone. The ultimate resistance to the harsh life on the plantations was to escape. In Brazil, some slaves who escaped founded states of their own. For almost the whole of the 17th century, Palmares, in northern Brazil, was an all-black kingdom. According to a Jesuit report,
the king has a palace and houses for his family and the service of all the guards and officials normally found in the house of a king.
At its height under King Zumbi, Palmares mobilized a royal guard of over 5,000 men. The black elite of Palmares bought slaves of their own and guns with which they fought off Portuguese invaders. Those without weapons practiced unarmed combat. This is capoeira, from which breakdancing developed. It originated as a courtship game in the southern African state of Angola. It became a sport whose beauty disguised its potential for deadly violence. The sense of Africanness in modern black Brazilians remains powerful. These rhythms are African. The lyrics speak of Zumbi and of Africa. One of the most poignant of the Candomblé ceremonies is that of Yemanjá, the sea goddess. Every new year, members of the Candomblé congregation make exquisitely decorated small boats to sail back to Mother Africa. The Netherlands, a damp smear of a country barely rising from the North Sea. Foreigners called it the buttock of the world. But this unpromising land would become one of the 17th century's greatest successes. At the end of the century, an Amsterdam merchant held a banquet. His menu celebrated the three stages of the Dutch Golden Age. Herring and cheese for its simple beginnings, roast meats when there was enough for everyone, French wines and delicacies when it all became too decadent. The Dutch East India Company sailed to distant shores, bringing back the world's spices: nutmeg, cloves, cinnamon. The key to Dutch success was an audacious new trade route, non-stop from Europe, wide of the southern tip of Africa, across the Indian Ocean using fast southerly winds, through a belt of perilous seas and on to the Spice Islands. The Dutch seized the existing trading posts, a high cost, high risk bid for the wealth of the world. For centuries, trade had enriched the East at Western expense. Now the Orient's highest value goods benefited shareholders in Amsterdam. The second stage of plenty, enough for everyone, had begun. New wealth paid for a new enthusiasm. Art for the middle classes. Commercial opportunities, combined with its reputation for religious and political tolerance, attracted men and women from all over Europe to the Netherlands. The French philosopher, René Descartes, settled there and wrote to a friend in Paris.
S'il y a du plaisir à voir croître les fruits de nos vergers,
if it gives us pleasure to see fruit grow in our orchard, do we not get just as much pleasure to see ships arriving laden with the wealth of the Indies?
Quel autre pays pourrait-on choisir?
In what other country are all the luxuries of life as easy to find as here?
Qu'en celui-ci.
A 1662 guidebook to Amsterdam boasted,
God has taken the riches from other cities and spilled them into our laps. Outwardly they may be modest, but you will find no private building so sumptuously magnificent as a great many of the merchants' and other gentlemen's houses are in Amsterdam.
Wealth made the Dutch uneasy, but their main emotion was pride. Amsterdam marked its commercial success with a new town hall, built by the citizens for the citizens. For the Dutch, Atlas held the universe, and Amsterdam was at its center. The Dutch poet Vondel called it the eighth wonder of the world.
Hoog tijd van het stadhuis en burgerheerschappijen met de jaarmarkt die met haar.
Our splendid town hall praises its citizens' power. A festive fair to which all our neighbors are invited. It is a glorious banquet with such promise of joy and abundance of treasures as only our artists can create.
Nu stapelen opeen.
The Dutch commissioned artists to furnish their homes. Rich merchants wanted portraits of themselves and those precious to them. Humbler citizens also commissioned paintings. These showed their world, not the grand world of the wealthy, but the stuff of everyday life. Simple family life was the Dutch ideal. For them, the perfect woman was
shapely of limb and of a fleshy stock, of pleasing aspect and clean of teeth, born in the realm of our own Netherlands.
But other paintings criticized declining morals through cryptic symbols. A conical glass was a firm breast. An open mussel or oyster was an available woman.
Some mussels are closed, but mine is always open.
The last stage of the Golden Age was at hand. Desire and luxury led to decadence.
Sluit voor begeerte uw graag gezicht. Zij loert om in te varen.
Desire is ever near.
Sluit de ogen.
So close your eyes, those windows of light.
Uw hart bewaren.
Lest it invade you.
Want want zo begeerte, want zo
preserve your heart and do not let yourself be conquered.
Zij zal bederf.
For desire will bring ruin and burning sin evermore.
Eeuwig smert en eeuwig druipt.
The Dutch were frightened that God would punish their excess by making their wealth disappear. Amsterdam's richest spent summer in their country houses. Here they collected the Netherlands' most expensive luxury. Paintings cost a few guilders, but in the 1630s, the tulip, a product of the exotic East, cost a fortune. People traded land, houses, gold and silver for a single tulip bulb. It couldn't last. The costs of empire proved too great for a republic corrupted by wealth.
Waar het goud begint.
Waar goud begint.
Waar het goud begint.
Where gold begins.
Is deugd maar wind.
Virtue is but wind.
Until the 17th century, China's science and technology were unchallenged. Now, a new threat was about to reverse the trend of centuries. China was a meticulously ordered society with a powerful emperor at its head. Each year he issued an official calendar. Dates for planting and harvesting were ordained in a world dwarfed by cosmic forces. Now his ability to predict the seasons was failing. The spring rains were late. Crops failed. Peasants starved. The emperor's authority was challenged. Jesuit missionaries from Europe offered the emperor a solution. They came to China with new mathematics, astronomical instruments, and an apparent novelty, a clock. The Jesuits learned the language and adopted Chinese names and dress. Their technology was welcome, but their religion was suspect. They were watched closely. Some were imprisoned. But they were saved when the emperor remembered the clock. When it stopped, only the Jesuits knew how to get it working again. The Jesuits were admitted to the interior of the Chinese imperial court. At the emperor's command, they set up their instruments in the imperial observatory. Tracking the paths of the sun and stars was the best way to determine time exactly. A solar eclipse was expected. Both the Chinese and Jesuit astronomers now had the chance to show what they could do.
The officials and students repaired to the observatory to study the eclipse of the sun. Only the prediction calculated by the Western method coincided with the primary eclipse, the total eclipse, the duration of the eclipse. Whereas the predictions calculated by the Chinese and Muslim methods contained errors.
Jesuits collaborated with Chinese astronomers to build new instruments and map the paths of the stars. Together, they managed the calendar on which the life of the empire depended. The instruments they installed in Beijing in 1673 fused Jesuit science with Chinese craftsmanship. They still survive, a strange symbol of the old amongst the high rises and neon. The Jesuits, in their turn, were fascinated by Chinese learning, the way Chinese characters are derived from pictures. It was a pagan script, but Christian scholars found it so beautiful that they thought it was mankind's original language, given by God. The Jesuits were impressed. The writing seemed to express more than any Western language could say. They introduced to European philosophy the teachings of Confucius, whose ideas about public and private life held a universal appeal. China had needed Jesuit science, but no longer needed the Jesuits. The emperor's position was now secure, but European astronomy and mathematics had gained respect in China. And in Europe, thanks to the Jesuits, Chinese ideas would help inspire the enlightened thinkers of the next century.